take these needs before the Lord and pray over the service.
Kind of like Brother Allen today, and I got a little frog in my throat. Makes it a little hard to talk. But I'm so thankful that everything worked out like it did with Brother Steve and him and that thing that happened. And it just, more and more you're seeing God do things that you're just beside yourself, you know. I think about Sister Courtney, you know, all the time that she's been unable to do things herself, and then when her children get sick, well, the Lord gave her strength that she'd been going right on and taking care of them. He's just so wonderful to do that which we have need of. Dear Heavenly Father, we bow in your presence once again, O Lord, knowing, O God, that we're here for the purpose of serving and worshiping and fellowshipping with you and with each other. And we thank you, dear Lord, that you look upon the circumstances of each one of your children and deal accordingly. And we know, Lord, that everything you do is right and that there's no mistake in what you do. We thank you, Lord, for the ministry that you've given in this last day. And not only do we pray for Brother Bud and Brother Allen, but for the ministry that you've called to minister in other places. Yes. Brother Spencer and those precious brothers in the Philippines and those in Norway. And Lord, we just don't know what some people have to go through to do the things that you've called them to do. But we're so thankful that each one of us can look to you and know that you won't ask us to do anything that you don't enable us to do. We thank you for that. We thank you, dear God, that we're able to come here and worship together. And I ask you, dear God, tonight that you would minister to all these that have been mentioned, and the many that have not been mentioned that still stand in need of thy touch. Help Brother Allen with his voice, dear God, that he may be recovered by the next time he needs to minister. And we ask just that you would come among us by your precious anointing tonight and bless our deacon brothers as they come to speak to us, Lord. And let it be that we shall find a sweet time of fellowship and harmony and unity in all that's said and done, not only tonight, but every time we come together. We give honor and praise and thanks unto thee, O God, in Jesus Christ's name, our precious Lord and Savior. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you.
It is no secret what God can do, what he's done for others, he'll do for you. Touching Jesus is all that matters, then your life will never be the same. Oh, there is only one way to touch him. Oh, just believe when you call on His name. Oh, touching Jesus is all that matters. Oh, then your life will never be the Jesus for the cleansing power. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Well, are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Oh, are you washed in the blood? Oh, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb. Well, are your garments spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Well, are you walking daily by the Savior's side? How are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Well, do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Oh, are you washed? Oh, in the blood. Well, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb. Well, are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Now when the bridegroom cometh, will your robes be white? Pure and white in the blood of the Lamb. Will your soul be ready for the mansions bright and be washed in the blood of the Lamb? Oh, are you washed in the blood? Oh, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb. Oh, are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Well, lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. For there's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Oh, are you washed in the blood? Oh, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb. Oh, are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Oh, are you washed in the blood? In the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb. Oh, are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
All right, you may be seated. Sister Carrie, would you have a song for us? Then Sister Michelle.
up to my home of rest. Troubled waters are splashing all around me. Surely
sisters for that. All right, Sister Michelle. Then Brother Duane, how about you after that?
the tempter knocked, but somehow I found strength to tell him no. What I once called pleasure, I just stood and watched them go.
Telling where I'd be. like to say to the young people, you know, I know we're all tempted with just temptations of every kind. If the devil can get you on the left hand, he'll get you on the left. If he can get you on the right, he'll get you on the right. But the Bible says to resist the devil and he'll flee from you. And he can't hear your prayers. So if you would just talk to the Lord during those times of temptation, the Lord will hold you. He will keep you from those temptations and he'll keep you from sin, and he'll strengthen you and give you what you need just when you need it. And I'm just so thankful that he's kept me from temptation and kept me planted here, and just thankful for all he's given me. I just love and praise him.
Thank you, sisters, for that. All right, Brother Dwayne and Brother Jimmy, how about you and Sister Sandy after that?
Amazing grace. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
and Sister Lori. How about you and Sister? Oh. Brother James, how about you after that?
Pray for us. We're a little nervous about singing this. This is one my grandmother wrote a long time ago. So,
stand up, we're in the army of the King. Stand up, stand up, we're in the army of the King. Stand up, we're in the army of the King. Oh, let his praises ring. Stand up, we're in the army of the King. Well, let's wait for an offering to the King. Let's wait, let's wait for an offering to the King. Let's wait, raise holy hands and shout. That's what it's all about, for an offering to the King. Let's wait, sing praise. Oh, glory to the King, sing praise, sing praise. Oh, glory to the King. Let's make the rafters ring. Oh, glory to the King. Sing praise. Let's pray on our knees unto the King. Let's pray. Let's pray on our knees unto the King. Let's pray. Let's pray every day, and God will show the way. On our knees unto the King. Let's pray.
Sister Diane, how about you and Sister Gloria after that?
Then sings my soul.
Kevin and Sister Sandy after that.
Where no storm clouds cry. Oh, they tell me of as a child I could not see what God really meant to me. Though in childhood I was taught to kneel and pray, God has blessed me through the years, but this God is always near. What the Lord has given me can take away. If God should choose, I could lose everything in a moment's time. All I have belongs to Him. Anyway, all my silver and my gold, all the treasures of my soul, these forever I could lose if God should choose. Now without God my life would be like a ship tossed on the sea. I would
each one of you for your songs, and happy birthday, Brother Cox. Let us all stand. I'll turn the service over to Brother Allen at this time.
Well, praise the Lord. I'm going to rest my voice tonight. I've didn't think that I better push it anymore. And it's been a long time since we've heard from the deacons. And used to hear from them quite often, but we're gonna do that at this time. So let us pray right now. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for your wonderful grace to us and your love and strength. And Lord, I pray now for your children, Lord, and for these, our brothers that are going to stand here tonight to give a word of testimony. I pray that you would bless each one of them as they do what they feel in their heart to do. And I pray, Lord, that you would just be with them as the words they say. Strengthen them and encourage their hearts. Encourage your people's hearts now. We pray in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. And Brother Berta is going to be first tonight. Come on, brother.
Musicians, stay where you're at. Sorry.
One thing that Brother Jackson did, having the deacon speak, I was hoping Brother Allen forget about, but obviously he hasn't. Let me just go for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for this opportunity to say a few words for you. But Lord, you see, I'm not good at words or expressing myself. But Lord, I pray that you just give me the words to say, that I may say something, Lord, that'll edify your people. In Jesus' name I ask it. I'd like to start. This is 2 Timothy 3, verse 1 says, "This know also, that in the last days perilous times will come." And those times are here. You heard what Brother Allen preached this morning about the pestilence and all that is going on. And that we are in the end time. And I'd like to read the 91st Psalm. For it is a protection that the saints of God have in this time. We know that lots of things are going to come upon this world. But we also know that the Lord is on our side, and that he is able and willing to take care of us. It starts out, "He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty." So first of all, it is he that abideth in the shadow of the Almighty. If we're not abiding in him, this psalm does not apply to us. We have to be in him, a child of God, for these verses to be for us. "I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy truth, thy shield and buckler." And it is, I'm thankful for the truth that the Lord has given us. It is the truth that we are in that'll be our shield and our buckler. "Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day. 1,000 shall fall at thy right, at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the Lord of the wicked." It's a wonderful promise that we have. And you see in the world today, they talk about bacteria, flesh-eating bacteria, bacteria that are not antibiotic, can't touch. And we can see different plagues and different pestilences throughout the world today. But to know that the Lord will protect us from that, that we have don't need to be afraid of it, that we have the peace that only the Lord can give us in a time like this. And it's a peace in the time of trouble. And this is surely a time of trouble that we are in today, but the Lord is with us. "Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation." And truly, he is our habitation. For without him, where would we be? I just thank him for that. "There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against the stone or land in a tree. But the Lord, see, right? You see, right there is the protection of the Lord that He has for each and one of us, that He can take care of us in any situation that come our way. He can cause a tornado, sister, to turn and go a different direction, sister. He can do whatever He takes to protect His children. You know, He is the mighty God, and there is none like Him. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet, because He has set His love upon me. Therefore I will deliver him. I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. And it's true that the peace that the Lord can give us when there's trouble, when there's trouble in our lives, when there's things that fall our way that we say, Lord, I wonder why. But one thing Jesus did promise, He said, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. And I've found this to be true, that we know that things fall our way that are troublesome to us. But one thing also that's in the scriptures is Romans 8:28 says that all things work together to good to them that are called to love the Lord. And I found that to be true. There's been times when I said, Lord, how can this be to my good? It's a bad situation. I guess I'll say it again. I've probably mentioned that my mom and dad were killed in an automobile accident. And at that time I said, Lord, did you have to take both of them? Couldn't you left me one? And I said, Lord, I don't see how this can work to my good. But now I can see, my mom and dad lived, I would have had to been there in Milwaukee to take care of them. I couldn't have come down here. So you see, it worked to my good. Even though at the time, it surely didn't seem like anything for my good. So I just praise the Lord for His peace and what He can give to us. And then I'd like to read the 23rd Psalm, because it's been one the Lord made special to me. When I was going to Milwaukee to my brother-in-law's funeral, I was asked to say something, and the Lord gave this to me. If the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. So the important thing is that the Lord is my shepherd. If the Lord's not our shepherd, if we're not following Him, because the sheep follow the shepherd, so we must be following Him in His word, and in the word that's presented to us, for Him to be our shepherd. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. Still waters is a peaceful setting, isn't it? And that's what the Lord has for us. We can have a peace in our heart no matter what comes our way, no matter what tragedy or what happens in our lives. There's a peace that the Lord can give to you that'll keep you through it, that you won't have to be upset about it. But you need just to be able to rest in His peace. The Lord has a special peace for His children. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And he truly has led us in the paths of righteousness. And in the word that has been being preached from this pulpit is to lead us in the paths of righteousness. For this is truly an end time, and a time when a serious time. And this is the best part, I think. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And I think I skipped the verse that says, thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. And surely our cup can run over in the joy that the Lord can give to us in every situation. So I'm not a public speaker, and I don't have cannot say a whole lot, but I just thank the Lord for his blessings and what he's done for me in my life.
Thank you, brother. Appreciate that very much. Love what he had to say there. Very, very encouraging. All right. Hope and Becky, sing for us, please. Sometimes if you don't give somebody time, it takes a little time to get it done.
can search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. Your mercy flows like a river wide, healing comes from
David. I'll have him to come out now and say what's on his heart. Thank you, Brother Berta. Appreciate that.
Well, I had talked to Brother Allen yesterday on the phone. When he calls, we talk for a little bit, and I had told him then that I had Charles run some stats for me on just kind of things that are going on with the internet as far as the viewers overseas and just everybody, and he said, well, maybe you ought to just talk about that sometime. I was like, okay, that's fine. I didn't realize it was going to happen in 24 hours. So you just never know what you volunteer. You don't... What comes back, but I just thought it would be nice for you to hear some of the things that, you know, that are happening out there and what people are really doing. We know people watch, but sometimes we don't know the numbers, and I was even surprised myself. And first I want to read a scripture here, Matthew 24:14. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. And you know, truly, we've seen that happen here. And, you know, the ministers can travel, but they can only go so many places and stuff. And, you know, at one point, you know, that's all they could do. But as things progressed, you know, the contenders started. And I mean, remember Dad even saying he just thought then it would just be something that they would publish just a few times, a few topics, and that would be it. And, you know, they started it in 1969, so it's almost 40, going on 45 years now that it's still going. And so, you know, and I can remember Dad saying it's not, the contenders not to replace the Bible, but just to be a tool to use to give insight to what the Scripture is saying. And it's went out there, you know, and over, I've got here over... Let's see here. Over 20 or 41 countries it's going to. And there's still 3,500 copies that go out 8 times a year overseas and around 600 here in the States. And, you know, for many of the places overseas, we have to remember internet is expensive for them. You know, they can't, they might not be able to afford it. They can't get the bandwidth strong enough to even watch a service. So that Contender is still doing its job. It's still doing its, it's being a tool used. And what I'm excited about is that this Contender is not reprinting old sermons. It's new, fresh stuff that's still going out. Again, it's we're printing out what Brother Allen is preaching now, and it's fresh revelation that's going out. And that, you know, we just thank the Lord for that. And but then to go into and just some of the countries, and I know Ramona said that a new one was Peru. We had never had it before, and that was just requested in the last year. But you know, it goes everywhere: Canada, Brazil, England, Fiji, Finland, Ireland. You know, some places I can't even pronounce on here. So it's just amazing where it goes. Sri Lanka, Trinidad, Ukraine. So you just don't know what that tool is for those people. And we've heard the testimonies how some have discovered it through packaging inside of a box, you know, and started reading it. So, you know, God knows every individual soul that's out there, and he finds them no matter where they're located. And he'll bring whatever avenue he has to use to get to them, to introduce them. But then, you know, things progressed, and now the internet became available. And it's, you know, amazing what people are still being able to do on it. And, you know, I know we've had people leave, and I wondered then, you know, how much is it going to drop down? You know, just wasn't really for sure how much. And when we got these stats, I was just astonished. On an average service, on a Sunday, we have anywhere from 100 to 110 connections. And for many of these places, this is not just one person watching, it's several. So we don't know what the true number of people is that's watching with us, that are having church with us right then. And, you know, they have the benefit of taking that. I've heard Brother Joel tell me that in Minnesota, you know, they take their laptop and run a cable to their TV. And so they're watching it on a big screen, you know, and they just feel like they're right here. So they're doing what they can to be a part of this service with us. And, you know, where two or more are gathered, he's in the presence. And we thank him. But like on a Thursday, 60 to 70 connections on a Thursday. And so that's a lot to be watching live. And at one high the highest point in the last 6 months, there was over 150 connections at one service. And I'll tell you that that's about what we had before people left. So, you know, there might have been some that left, but God has also brought new ones along, the ones that are appreciating it and really, you know, are hungry for that truth to come out. Let's see. You know, just watching daily, you know, when people just, many times they can't watch a live service, or if they're on the other side of the world, they might be asleep while we're having church. So there's many people watching archives daily. And again, I wondered how many is that? And there's at least around an average of 90 to 110 viewers watching a service every day. So, you know, people are hungry. They go back. And sometimes we, you know, we take for granted, you know, Brother Allen said this morning, there's sometimes people that would be thrilled to have a seat sitting here. And so it just makes you really humble and appreciate what we have here. You know, they're watching older sermons and new stuff too. So they're not just strictly watching one certain topic. They're watching everything over. And that's audio, broadband, and mobile. And, you know, the internet has advanced, and, you know, people are able to access stuff on their phones, and tablets came out. So we wondered, you know, what's that really going to do? We started getting requests, and I asked Brother Charles if that's something we can do. And, you know, he investigates it. I can't thank the Lord enough for Brother Charles. And he sends people along that has that knowledge. You know, I do very little for all of this. And he has that knowledge, and the Lord has blessed him. And if I bring up a topic, he'll research it and figure it out. And So, you know, we've got it out there where people can watch on their phones now. I know Brother Danny Dreschel, he's watched on his phone while he's out driving. Not while he's driving, but I mean when he's on the road and he has a chance. But he does watch. I've heard him say on his phone. And, you know, people watch on tablets and stuff. And so I was curious, you know, what is that? And so it's roughly around 25% of people are moving to that avenue. You know, it's easier to, you know, sit in the living room together, you know, and look at something like that versus having to crowd around a computer desk and try to watch. And so it's slowly moving into that. 35% of our live sessions when we're streaming live, they're watching on a tablet or a phone or something. It's just moving into that. Let's see here. And then as far as the connections, people visiting pages on the internet and watching services, over 76 different countries. So again, we just, you know we have brothers and sisters in Norway, we know we have them in Philippines and Canada, but we also have brothers and sisters all over this world that we may not have even had a chance to talk yet, but they're checking things out. You know, the top five are usually always still, it's United States, Norway, South Africa, Canada, the Philippines, but then it goes into the United Kingdom, and Singapore, and Nigeria, and India, and, you know, that's just the ones at the top. They're still, again, all over this world. It's just amazing to see that. And something as far as, you know, when you are watching on your phone or your tablet or something like that, these devices require you got to have some kind of data plan. And, you know, when people did start watching that, that was the one thing they were finding out. You know, when you stream a live service or you watch something for 2 hours, it really eats your data up. And we wondered, you know, what are we going to be able to do? And again, I went to Charles and asked, you know, what kind of avenues can we look at? And, you know, there's something called podcasting that you can upload things to iTunes, and then the person can download that service to their PC and then transfer it over, and so they don't have to watch on the broadband or on their eat their data up and everything. So we started that, I believe, in the middle of July, and that's from July of this year, and there's been over 2,200 downloads. People are downloading those services and watching them, and it's average of 23 downloads per each sermon. So it's, you know, we've got Thursday night, Sunday morning, Sunday night services on iTunes, and people are taking advantage of it. And people are hungry. They're hungry for truth. They want to know what's going on. They want to be informed, and it's just amazing. As far as this morning, Charles ran it for me. We had 112 connections this morning. 86 of them were broadband. 23 were Apple or Android devices, and then 3 audio. And when we started this, broadband was expensive, and, you know, we only had maybe 3 or 5 connections of broadband. Everybody else was watching low quality, and but slowly the internet has come down, and people are investing in it. They want, you know, they're putting forth that effort just to be able to watch a better, you know, we hope a better quality. And so, yeah, 86 broadband connections this morning. So that, again, it's just amazing what God's being able to do and get his truth out there. So we are going to have to, we'll update the websites. Our websites are very old. The code that they're used to run is just getting really outdated, so they've approached us and asked us we need to start updating. So we will try to make things a little bit easier, hopefully, to do on the internet from there. As far as the other, anything else that I would talk about, I wanted to maybe just read 2 more scriptures here. James 5:16 says, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that you may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And then Mark 11:24. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire. When you pray, believe that you receive them, and ye shall have them. It doesn't, you know, it's just clear. It's clear to the point. Pray. And I hear people sometimes say, you know, oh, I wish there was something I could do for the Lord and things. Prayer is one of the most powerful things you can do. We sing songs about it, but it's not just singing a song. It is truly a powerful thing, and it moves heaven. It touches God, and He will enact upon it. And I know for me, I've been the recipient of so much prayer, and I can't thank the family of God that's here. You know, Satan will come against you at times and try to get you down, but it's always, I've always felt the prayer of the people, of my brothers and sisters here when I've had to go through something. And I can't thank you enough. If God never did one more thing for me again, I can't ever even begin to thank Him for what He's already done. He has blessed me so much that I don't deserve. And He just, you know, yes, I might go through certain things, but I can still at times just find a song in my heart, and He just, His presence enters, and that's the sweetest thing, when He comes in that still small space, and all of a sudden you realize He's right there, and you're communicating right then. And I can't thank the Lord enough for that, but I thank the Lord for my brothers and sisters here. You, like I said, I felt your prayer so much, your courage, your thoughts, and everything, and when I was in the hospital that last time, it meant a lot. And I work at the hospital, and so the last thing I want to do is actually be a patient in there too. And it being in a hospital can sometimes be a very depressing thing, you know, when you're told that you're going to have your gallbladder and it's only a one-day procedure, and you end up being in there for 5 days. You just wonder what's going on. But, you know, through all of that, I knew that my brothers and sisters were praying for me, and I, again, just can't thank you enough for that. And, you know, we see the signs. We know that the end is coming soon, and whatever sicknesses and things that all of us are suffering, that's going to end one day very soon. And I can't wait to see that start happening for His bride. And I know that we've had people leave, and sometimes that, you know, it's easy to keep your mind focused on what's left, but I would suggest that we focus on the people that are staying and the ones that are here and the ones that have made a stand. And, you know, we have members in here who have lost a spouse, a child, or a parent, or whatever. You know, we've all been touched in some form or fashion of people leaving. And I want to say to those individuals, I pray for your strength to endure what you have to go through. I'm not walking in your shoes, and so I can't even begin to fathom that hardship, what it's like. But I see my brothers and my sisters still here, and that means so much. You all are stronger than what so you sometimes feel. And we just keep marching on. And the rest of us, you know, when you're having a good day and you're feeling good, pray for someone else. Pray for your brother and sister. Because if we're each praying for each other, the Lord is watching over every single one of us. And I just, if you have no one to pray for, then you can pray for me, because I sure will take every bit that I can get. I appreciate it. But I appreciate this truth, this church, what it stands for. I appreciate what our two pastors here are doing, the stand that they've made. And they've had to go through so much. And again, I can't even imagine what they're facing at times. And, you know, we go through stuff ourselves, and we know how much that occupies our mind. But our pastors hear problems from everywhere. And it's taxing on the mind. You know, it's taxing on the spouses or the family. And so we, again, prayer can be a powerful thing to lift them up, that they can have strength, they can have rest, they can have peace, because what they're bringing for us each week is the most important thing that we have to listen to. And I just thank the Lord for the truth that he's bringing daily. We still hear it. It's still fresh. It's still new. And I can't thank the Lord enough for everything. I thank him for my family, for their help that they give me back there in the room. And I'm just blessed. And I thank the Lord for everything that he's done for me. That's all.
Thank you, Brother David. I thank the Lord for the wisdom that he has put in the hearts and lives of our deacon brothers, and for the stand that they've taken. It wouldn't be easy without it. And I want to, as Brother David said, I thank you, Brother Charles. You have been a willing worker. And I appreciate that. I really do. I appreciate each one of you. And we're going to have another song, and then I'll let Brother Steve say what it's on his heart. And I'm going to ask the sisters to come and sing if they would at this time. Thank you, sisters. Very beautiful song. All right, Brother Steve, it's your time. Take your time, whatever you need. May the Lord bless you. Yeah? Be what? Okay.
There's peace in knowing, Lord, you're in control. You got your hand on my heart. You got a hold on my soul. There's joy abundant. I just have to tell. I'm drinking sweet water from your living well. When lost on life's journey, through valleys you lead. Lord, I know that you're everything I'll ever need. There's peace in knowing, Lord, you're in control. You got your hand on my life, you got a hold on my soul. Joy abundant, I just have to tell. I'm drinking sweet water from your living well.
You are my shelter, my cover in rain, my joy when I'm happy, my healer in pain.
You are my redeemer, you are my friend, you are my future beginning and end. There's in knowing, Lord, you're in control. You got your hand on my life, you got a hold on my soul. There's joy abundant, I just have to tell. I'm drinking sweet water from your living well. We're listening for thunder, voices to sound. When we get that message, we'll be leaving the ground. There's peace in knowing, Lord, you're in control. You got your hand on my life, you got a hold on my soul. There's joy abundant, I just have to tell. I'm drinking sweet water from your living well. There's peace in knowing, Lord, you're in control. You got your hand on my life, you got a hold on my soul. There's joy abundant, I just have to tell. I'm drinking sweet water from your living well.
I felt your presence, you felt me stand. We got it through trials by the touch of your hand.
When lost on life's journey, through valleys you'd lead. Lord, I know that you're everything I'll ever need. There's peace in knowing, Lord, you're in control. You got your hand on my life, you got a hold on my soul. There's joy abundant, I just have to tell. I'm drinking sweet water from your living well. We're listening for thunder, the voices to sound. When we get that message, we'll be leaving the ground. There's peace in knowing, Lord, you're in control. You got your hand on my life, you got a hold on my soul. There's joy abundant, I just have to tell. I'm drinking sweet water from your living well. There's peace in knowing, Lord, you're in control. You got your hand on my life, you got a hold on my soul. There's joy abundant, I just have to tell. I'm drinking sweet water from your living well.
Come on, Brother Steve.
Well, I really love that song. It says it up. Peace in your soul, knowing the Lord's in control. I hardly know what to say up here. It's a little known. Talked to Brother Bud or Brother Allen yesterday a little bit, and he said his throat was sore and was going to do a board meeting stuff. I said, well, you can always get Brother Bud to help you. That's what he's there for. And I don't know if Brother Bud swayed or I don't know what happened back there, but they're both grinning. but how the cart turns sometimes. But anyway, I know you want to hear a little bit about this incident, and I just thank for all the prayers and all, and I'll just tell it kind of as it happened. I don't know how else to do it and get over it quickly, but I went up there. I just kind of think in my mind, the grandkids are in school. I don't have to take care of them nearly as much as I used to, and I thought, well, I wouldn't mind to build a little altar light again in my garage maybe over the winter. I'd had them about 10, 12 years ago, and so that's kind of my mind, and I was kind of looking at the ads, you know, you see, and there was one for sale. Wasn't what I was looking at building, but it was a different type, but it's still more of a small plane, and well, I might take a look at that, and I called about it, and it's just up the road at French Lick, 45 minutes. We go up there for lunch sometimes and up there, and so he said, well, the pilot's going to be in the hangar, you know, 5 o'clock, and you can come look at it, and he'll fly it around for you. And that's what my plan was, go up there, watch him fly it. I wasn't really interested in getting it. I just wanted to see what it looked like, if it's something that maybe I'd be interested in building or whatever. But they started up, and he said, well, let's go for a ride. And I said, well, how much do you weigh? He only weighed 144 pounds. He was a very light person. So I did a calculation in my mind. I said, well, okay, we can handle that. Asking how much flight he had. He had 300 hours just in the last year alone, I thought he said, in a general aviation aircraft, and 25, 30 hours in this plane. I said, well, we'll just go up and, you know, pattern and come back down real quick. Yeah, no problem. Only got a few gallons of fuel anyway. So we go up there real quick, and he just doesn't seem to get very high, basically. And next thing I know, we're flying, and we've landed the tree. I'm not going to answer a lot of questions about what happened. That's the FAA's business. I'm sure they're going to grill him, and I pray for him because he was a pilot, and he's got some questions to answer. But I'm just going to leave it at that. And so, you know, the last thing it was, we was getting low in the trees. He had full power. He's trying to get out, but I can tell something wasn't going right. And you know, so I thought, well, we'll surely pull out of this. And next thing I know, he gave up on it, and he cut the power like you're supposed to if you know you're going to hit the ground and or tree. And he said, we're going down. And so I just kind of braced, and well, here we go. And it was just that quick. And there he was in a tree. I mean, we was at about a 60-degree angle, and I motor still running, so I reached in the key and got to tried to get the motor off, but it wasn't my plane. I'd been so long as I flow, he had two master switches to kill the electricity to everything. So he finally kind of, I think he was a little bit in shock what happened. He finally got the mags off, the prop is dead and silence. And here we're sitting there, and we're looking down this way, and I'm looking up to see what we're holding on to. And I said, well, let's just pray. That's the first thing I said. So I thank the Lord that we was alive and we've been caught by this tree, basically. And I said, Lord, you've kept me up to this point, so I got no fear. You know, you're going to get me through this. It's a matter of time. Just give us peace. And so after the prayer, why I kind of reached, he was down. He was almost down about this angle. He was really shoulder to shoulder, but we're just tore like that. And I said, well, how far up are we? Are we 15, 20 feet? And I'm hoping, you know. And he says, oh, no, I think we're 80 or better. And I said, well, I said, it can't be 80 because I think the highest trees in Indiana is about 70, 75. So it won't be that bad. He says, it's bad. And so best we can do, we knew we was pivoting on one little branch. It's hard to maybe explain it, but the plane coming to this tree, and there's a fork like this, the main body going up, and there's a limb going up there about 4 inches in diameter. The wing spar and the wing actually cut that branch off about that far up. But yet it didn't cut the wing into. It just bent it bad. It cut through that 4-inch branch, hit the main body of the tree, blowed the bark off, and then nestled down in that fork. And that's what was holding on that 2-inch tube, about 2.5-inch tube. Sheet metal formed, and so we was hanging, but that was all it was. And we was in the top of this tree within 10 or 15 feet. If you've seen the news video, you've probably seen that. So it was, you know, you've seen what was going on, you've seen this and everything. I said, well, they'll just have to come get us somehow. So I called Elsie, told her, and she'd heard the engine, you know, and says, where are you all at? And I said, well, we're in a tree. And That's all I kind of know how to tell it, you know. I ain't no use to lie about it. I said we're in this tree and we're quite a ways up it, but we're fine. Everything is doing good. We're planes are secure and we're just staying still and we'll keep you informed. And I thank the Lord for cell phones. I don't think I've used hardly 10 or 15% of a battery in a cell phone all my life in a day's time. And by the time I got home, I looked and I'd used almost 70% because people was calling and rescue was in touch with us, the cell phones and different things. And plus, I took a few pictures and video up there. We might have taken some, but I thank the Lord we had that. And there was just a peace. I wasn't nervous a bit. I just was up there wondering how they're going to get up there, thinking how high can they get a bucket or something. I knew that was what's going to end up. And I know Brother Jackson used to say, don't ever say never. And I've always said, you'd never get me up one of them 40-foot cherry pickers. Well, it took a 60-foot to get us down. But it was for several hours. It was an ordeal. But in my mind, I just said, well, Lord, I know if in a few hours or whatever it takes, I'm going to be walking down that road down there, and I'm going to be seeing Elsie and the they had a pilot's lounge, whatever you call it, and we'll be getting the car and driving off. There was just no doubt in my mind that was happening, and I even envisioned myself standing right here. That's just the peace and confidence that he will give you. And you wish you can have that all the time. But the thing is, we're in the way. I have to honestly say that because I know my own life. I mean, there are people know me. I'm not always peaceful and always content. You know, I get flustered at work and things, and different things happen. But why is that? You know, and I up there 4 hours, you're sitting up there, you're leaning over, and you ain't going to do anything but kind of move your head this way or move your head that way, and that's all we're doing. Because every time you move, the plane, you can hear it. And it was such a pressure on our hip because your feet is running rudders on an airplane. Your feet are free, so there's nothing really for your feet. They're just wanting to lay over the edge of the seat. And so it's all on your hip, and every 4 or 5 minutes we had to move. We grabbed the root tube, and we kind of just pull ourselves up, and you hear this stuff, and we do as careful as we could and move an inch, and, oh, I feel so much better. And we both took turns. We'd tell each other, I'm going to move, you know, because It just kind of was that. You know, it's just the way it is. But there really wasn't anything we can do. And when you cannot do nothing, and you know you cannot do nothing, then the roadblock to that peace is gone. Because that's all you have. You know, in our life, if we think there's 0.1% of one chance we can do something, God, I'll see you later. You know, I got to fix this, Lord. Help me, Lord, fix it. It's always, Lord, help me fix it. You know, it's hard to say, Lord, you've got total control. But when you get in a situation like this, it don't take but an instant to know it's all Lord and none you. None Steve, none of my experience. Don't make any sense to go back 30 seconds and say, well, if I was flying, we wouldn't be over this woods. It don't matter. You're here. This is what's going on. And you're staring a catastrophe possibly in the face. But just the fact that we was living, I looked up at this tree trunk and seen that, and I said, well, what's the odds of that happening? I mean, it's just amazing. I don't think you can duplicate that one out of 1,000 times if a professional pilot was trying to hang his airplane on that limb. It'd be like throwing a horseshoe 1,000 yards and nailing it. It's just the way it happened, and nothing else broke. And it's just, I'm sure everybody's been there a little bit to that time. There's nothing new under the sun. And I was trying to keep the pilot positive. He was fairly positive. He never said a foul word to me. And, you know, he'd laugh at some things I said and whatever, and never complained when I prayed. And you know, my thoughts went to some of the saints that's been to much worse stuff. I mean, you look at this, and it looks bad at the time, but I didn't look at it that way. And I just, in my mind, well, it's going to be 2 or 3 hours. I'm going to be in this position, and that's kind of rough. Lord, just give me peace here. But I told him, I said, I had a brother at church, Jim Barber. I said, driving a truck that, you know, someone ran him off the road or whatever, end up upside down. All this stuff coming through him, ends up with his arm up over his head, upside down. The belt's trapped him. He can't hardly breathe, and a mouthful of gravel and asphalt. And he was there for several hours, if I remember right. I don't know exactly how long it was, but I'm thinking we're sitting here pretty comfortable. You know, we're just sitting there nice and quiet, and we're not fighting no injuries or nothing like that. And I thought we're in a much better shape than what he was, and I told several stories of like that. And, you know, what Sister Courtney is going through for children, how much more that is a situation in life that we fight. And it's hard to give that over to the Lord. It's hard to give it over for us. And then it's much harder to give it over for our children's sake. We look at them, we do this, you know, and we worry, we're concerned, and we want to do everything we possibly can. So I'm up there and I'm thinking these things, this really isn't nothing. There's nothing too hard for God. And, you know, of course it seems to be, oh, well, you know, if you're 60 feet, that's a lot worse than 55. Well, 10 feet, you fall on your head, it's going to kill you, you know. So it's just in our minds of this height thing and whatever. And I couldn't help but think while I was there that, you know, they probably lifted our Lord and Savior probably 10 or 15 feet off the ground so everybody could see. Everybody could mock him. And he went up there willingly. And he knew there was no one on the ground working to get him off. You know, my mind just seemed to go to, he had to see that big burly man there with a club nearby, that if he didn't die quick enough, he'd break his legs. That's what his rescue he seen. And I'm sure they had it right there where everybody could see it, that if he didn't die quick enough, they'd break his legs and make it a little bit quicker. But also know that Jesus, though he seen it, he knew the scripture, his not a bone would be broken. So I look at that, and he willingly went there for us. It was not that much of an ordeal for what little I went through. For 4 hours, they got the lift up there. Everything went right. They tried one lift, and just couldn't get to us, and they went and got one at the Orleans REMC. They want everybody to know that, so I'm going to tell that. I thank the Lord for Orleans REMC truck. You know, it was sitting there. It could have been the shop, could have been repaired, but it was there, and they got it there after dark, and it was able to go to 60 feet. And they got within about 18 inches of the plane, and the heads of the people was, you know, pretty even with us. And so they start working. They tied the plane off. They tied the back somehow or another, and the wheel off a little bit. Was afraid it may try to flip back out if, you know, weight shifting around trying to get out. And but they was able to. We was able to drop down in that bucket, and they got us out of there and had to clear some trees on the way down. So it took me. It seemed like forever to get down, but it was probably about 15 minutes. The trees they kind of pushed out of the way to get up. They just snapped back under the lift, and when it come down, it was right on top, so they couldn't get down. So we was moving the bucket back and forth, and they was sawing that tree off in four-foot hunks, and we was pushing it down, and we'd go over, come down, and come this way and push it down and until we got back on the ground. But when we was up there, after I'd called Elsie, said she was, you know, I was all right and everything, and I called Brother Bud. I knew he was camping in the forestry somewhere as far away than I thought it was. I thought he was just up the road, but that park was closed because of shutdown, I guess. But told him what I was, and I was calm, you know. I said, well, I would appreciate prayer, and might need that, you know. It's you know, we get in those situations, we examine our lives, and, you know, the old devil says, well, you're not worthy to pray for yourself. You better get someone else helping you. And but the scripture says, you know, the saints pray. And you lift each other's up, and that's what brings that peace. You know that. You know there's people involved in it. Everybody's doing the best they can to get you down. And you soul search, and you're thinking up there. But before you know it, you're back down the ground, and, you know, you're thanking the Lord. And I do thank the Lord for the whole ordeal. I was up there, and the scripture come, take joy in trials and tribulations and things. And I said, oh, Lord, I'm real joyful. I'm still living. But the exact situation could be a little better. But we're secure, you know. And that's how we did. We, no panic. There's just a peace there, just enduring the ordeal. It was an endurement. That's all it was. I wasn't worried. I wasn't concerned. I just felt for sure that everything be okay. It's just a time thing. Time thing is what it was. And I think Elsie, she ended up calling Brother Allen. She talked to him. I hated to bother Brother Allen, but I knew Brother Bud would probably call him anyway. And so I said, well, Elsie, go ahead and call him. It'll be fine. Our phones was tied up a lot. We're shoulder to shoulder, as we couldn't both use the phone. I mean, if the phone rang and he was on, I couldn't hear, and he couldn't hear me, and then chainsaws was going. They had to cut trees down just to get to us back there. So it was kind of difficult, and paramedics was calling us every 15 minutes or so, checking, are y'all doing okay or whatever, and this thing here. So it was quite a busy time. We weren't just sitting there idle all the time. It's like there's always something going on. And I was trying to get to see what we was at, because I couldn't see the ground from my side. I can look out a little bit this way and see the airport, top of the airport okay, and looked like the cornfield. And I thought, well, this don't look like we're that high up from my vantage point. But the ground fell away swiftly, and I was trying to take a picture and then look at the picture. And the other apostle, well, that's an iPhone, isn't it? I said, yeah, it is. He said, well, you can turn the camera around. It'd be a lot easier. And I said, oh, okay. So I look at it, you know, I said, okay, I hit that. And there's my big face in that camera. And I said, oh, that's terrible. And I said, but it was advantageous, like a mirror. So then I could look down over my shoulder, and there's someone standing down. I didn't even know it. They stand down there looking up at me, and they look small. I said, yep, we're up. We're up pretty high. And so I was, you know, signing that around, so I seen that video, so I pushed that. So, okay, well, take a little video while I'm up here. That's what Summit was on the news there. And of course, you know, he got us down and whatever and gave all the information out, and we drove home. And the next day, I couldn't sleep at night at all, hardly, and might as well get up around, I think, about 6 o'clock, and went back up there and seen the plane, you know, from below. And it was even worse than what I thought it was. I thought we was in several trees because we seen, you know, 3 or 4 trees up there. And I went and tie us off this one. It'll probably do that. But we was only in one tree. It's just one tree. And it went all just straight up the top and then forked off about 3 pieces. And that's what we was hung in up there, and that one branch. And it was, as Brother Allen mentioned, it was an elm tree. And they was bringing the bucket up, and they was having trouble getting up high enough because they couldn't get in. They was having to reach out before they can come up, and it wouldn't reach us. He got to about 8 feet of us. So we this ain't going to work. Well, we don't want to hear that, you know, but that's okay. They'll figure something out. Then the other guy in the bucket said, "Man, that's an elk, that's a ash tree too. That thing lobbed it snap into any minute." Well, I said, "We're on a need to know basis up here, you know, wherever you're at, you know." But I don't know a whole lot about trees anymore. But I guess the fact was is this bug, this emerald ash bug, or they call it, is a beetle, is eating through the trees, and the worms just bore holes through them, and they're dying, and most of them don't have half the wood they should because they've been ate out of them. And that's what they're referring to. And when they did get us down, you know, I did not realize that the Department of National Resources, they're the ones that takes care of stuff that happens in a woods. Everything's so separate out anymore. So I was handed over to them, and he said, DNR, you know, and I says, "Oh," I said, "I wouldn't ride my four-wheeler illegally back here." You know, and that's what I know him for, always after that. But he just laughed. He said, "No, but you hit a major tree back here." But he said, "I'm just kidding." But so I was really appreciative to them. I know there was Mr. Hash, I believe it was, Jim Hash, I believe, was the key man up in the bucket, and he had a helper up there. And then there's someone using the bucket, which probably might have been some of REMC, and probably 5 to 10 more paramedics or whatever waiting to come down, and probably 50 bystanders. But I think all that was able to help me. And so anyway, we got back to the little pilot's lounge there for Elsie, and first thing I caught, I got a big glass table. She gave me a big hug and all this, and so we was looked on that table, or somebody wanted to talk to me, and so I just happened to look down, and there's a great big book about this big square, hardbound book, you know, I guess for just general reading, and the cover said Miracle in Spring Valley. So I said, "What book was made for me?" You know, so I took a picture of that, and then we finally could make our way home. And when I got up that next morning and took the video before I left, I was kind of checking the news, and I didn't see anything. I just seen crash lands and, you know, off the light and tree, and everybody okay. I said, "Well, good, that's the way I want it." I told my pilot there, and some others said, "Now, to ask any question, my name is John Doe, and I just fine with me." And so, when I come back, though, we had some email and stuff, and some, I guess it got on the news more. My name was mentioned, and so, okay, this is the way now it's getting out then. And then about, we went out, do something, and we come back, and I had a phone call from Chris Turner at 41 News, wanted to come out to the house and interview me. And I just, you know, it was a message. I said, "Well, I ain't going to call him up. I sat down there, and I was dead tired anyway, and I said, "Well, I'll just see what he wants." So I called him up, thank a nice gentleman, and said, "I just want to come out for 15 minutes of your time and get some, we got some questions answered, but there's a few others I'd just like to do a little interview with you. Won't take 15 minutes. And it seemed like a nice enough voice on that end, you know, and I just felt, I said, "Well, I tell you what, I'm going to just tell you up front, this is the way it is. If you want to come talk to me, I'm going to give my Lord and Savior, God, the glory. This is, you know, that's all it is. It's going to be probably more than once. And if that goes against you, or you think it goes against your studio, or goes against your people going to read it, then you might as well save yourself a trip." And he said, "No." He said, "No." He said, "I believe a man's faith is very important in crisis." And I said, "Well, if that's what you'll do, and then I'll talk to you." So he was down there in about an hour or less and had a video camera and stuff. And well, one thing while he was coming, I got this video out. I got it on my camera and put it on the TV I had in there. And I had some other video on the computer that I take off the cell phone. I put it up. And well, I showed them that while they setting the camera up. And so they was really amazed I had all that. And so I said, "Well, I've got a video also on my iPhone while I was up in the plane." And they said, "Really?" So I showed them that. So they really liked that. And I said, "Well," and we've been talking about the incidents, you know, just talking this and that. And so I said, "Well, why don't you just use that video? You don't need me on camera. You got your answers. You know, you can just show the video and go on." He said, No, I want you on camera." And he said something. Brother Allen said the same thing this morning. He looked at me and said, "You've got a fire in your belly." He said, "You'll do fine to interview." He said, "You ain't going to be thinking of what to say. It just comes out of you." Well, okay. So we sat and talked for probably a half hour on this camera. Of course, they edited it all down to whatever. And I just told him what happened. I thanked the Lord for it, and he didn't seem like it offended him any, and seemed like it didn't offend his cameraman any, and they put several praise the Lords on the video, I think, of what I understand. I've seen it a time or two, and I thank the Lord for that, because this day and age, you know, you wonder what they're going to edit out of it. And I got a phone call from him about an hour before the news edit went on last night, and he said they want it to go national with that story. And I said, well, what does that mean? He said, well, it'd be an ever Fox 41 station that would pick it up. That's what they're wanting to do. And I said, well, I trust you, Chris. What are the drawbacks of that? And he said, well, said they're not going to take my interview. They will take the story, and they'll do whatever they want to do if the pictures is what they're going to do. And I said, well, so Lord ain't going to get no glory out of just pictures. I don't tell what they might say. So I said, well, what's your recommendation? He said, well, he said, I just wait. Knowing you, I just wait. So I did. I didn't. I said, well, okay, it's good enough for me. I ain't going to worry about it. Because I didn't want someone taking some other story and twisting the facts or how they are, you know. I trusted this man because he's in my home. And I thought he did right by me. I really do from way I seen it. But peace in knowing. I would have hated to be up there worried sick that that plane's going to drop any minute. And I really wasn't too concerned. I did everything I knew how to do for it not to, naturally. But it was in the Lord's hand, the Lord's control. And I thank everybody for praying for us. And, you know, as something else was on my mind, I just told a brother texting just this week, you know, about we're all looking for unity. Brother Jackson always said unity will have to start the ministry. The congregation can't solve the ministry's problems, is not going to set the ministry straight. But, you know, in my mind, probably 99% of the ministry problems is the congregation. You know, and I would say, yeah, we get our problem, get tied up in something. The devil reaches out there and touches somebody. And if he can go down a family line, and by the time the problem gets so big, the minister's got to take care of it, he knows somebody ain't going to like his decision. There's going to be one side or the other side. The devil uses the congregation, the laity, to cause the trouble for the ministry most of the time. That just seems the way it is. Moses did not get to see the promised land because he struck the rock instead of speaking to it. And why? Because he was so tired of the Israelites not believing God's going to take care of them the next day. And I just pray that I'm not a problem to the ministry. You know, we got the saying around America here, or used to be in my days when I was in school, if you're not part of the solution, then you must be the problem. So I pray for the ministry, and I hate to be a problem here and call them up and worry. And Brother Allen said he was very concerned, worry. That saddens me that I might have been I was the cause of that. And I don't want to be the cause of worried anybody. I know on the phone, he's kind of making a little joke up here, and I did that little video. I said the plane was for sale real cheap and today. I said, no, if Elsie would let me fly again, I showed Elsie, I forgot about that. And that night I was doing something else. Oh, I forgot I took this video, Elsie. Look at this video and come that part. But I don't think Elsie's going to let me fly. So you're a prophet right there. So I don't think I'm going to be doing that no more. I thank the Lord for a loving wife that takes good care of me and has been through some things. And, you know, she just keeps on. She didn't act mad at me or anything like that, and just probably glad it was over. And I thank the Lord for that. I know she's been through a lot worse stuff than that. She's through the cancer operation, but the Lord's always brought us through. Always has and always will. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. And I thank everybody. I can probably ramble on here forever, but I think I've said all I can say. And again, I thank everyone for praying, for your concern, and I can feel that when I was up there. And I thank God for the peace he gave me. And surely there's something to learn from that, because it's a testimony does begin with the word test. You know, you say, oh, the Lord surely had his hand on you. Oh, he could have kept it on me till I landed, you know. things like this. You know, he saves us and he takes care of in situations sometimes we get ourselves into. But why did he let us get in that situation? He could have just took care of it all the way. We never known the difference. And he does every day. I believe every time you get in a vehicle and you get on the highway, you are being protected. You are being protected every second. You cannot get away from God. That is one thing we must know. We cannot get away from God. You know, they always want to find life on Mars. Well, look for God. You'll find God on Mars. He's everywhere. But they don't want to see that sign of life. They want to see this human stuff there. Look at the Maker. Look for the Maker that made Mars or any planet. Look in His Scriptures. You'll see how it got there. You may be looking through a glass darkly, but you'll get a real good inkling of what all happened. So we cannot get away from God. We live in His surrounding, His presence all over us. If we didn't, Satan would snuff our life out instantly. He had to go to God, and God let him attack Job. It wasn't going to happen without it. And what was the last case, you know, he wanted to touch his body. And he says, okay, you can touch his body then, but you're not going to take his life. And, you know, Job, I think, knew that. And I believe Job's wife knew that. Because what did Job's wife tell him? Brother Kevin's sister Sandy sings the song, curse God and die. So she must have knew something there. Or why would she say, go ahead and curse him, and then it's over. You know, then you'll die. But as long as he's going to stand fast, he wasn't going to die. He's going to stand fast. And even though people was coming against him, say, you ought to do this or that, devil coming against him with sores and boils, he's saying, the Lord God will take care of me. And that's the way it is. Whatever situation comes, he'll take care of us. But yet, we cannot forget there's a reason, there's experience there, there's something there that will help us reexamine our lives a little bit closer. Because we also want to get closer to God, but maybe not the way he chooses us to get closer, but that's how he brings us closer. But thank you again. I appreciate what all the two other brothers have said here. The internet goes off, Brother David. I appreciate that. I know I was really sick during convention. It was all I could do to get here on the night service. But every day, me and Elsie did the same thing. I have a little laptop. I found I could plug it in there and plug it in my TV. Had a port there. And we was watching it all on a 70-inch TV in the back room there. And I was watching another archive video when the grandkids come in. And I said, look here, Sophie, there's Brother Allen. She says, yes, but he's too close. We're used to sitting back there, and here it looks like the camera is sitting. Well, the camera is there, but they got him zoomed in. So on TV, you just see about the head and shoulders, and he looks like you're on the front row. But I appreciate that and being able to see that. It's not like being here, but it sure gives you comfort that in this age, that even though the devil uses all this garbage for his use too, the Lord will get his glory out of technology. And I thank for that. So God bless you all, and take care, and have a good, safe trip. And I pray I don't have to call you up anymore and say I'm in trouble.
I was looking at this little screen here that we have here. And Brother Steve, you look just like he did on television when I saw you yesterday. I really appreciate my brothers. Appreciate it. Makes me kind of swell up inside to know the testimony that each one of them has. And to be able to hear it myself. And I'm going to have to kind of be like the preacher said one time, I'll go along with Sister Ella, Elsie, say, lo, I'm with you always. Let us stand, please, and I'll turn the service over, Brother Bud.
You'll catch on.
Thank you, brothers, for your testimonies, and praise the Lord. If anyone wants to come for prayer, then feel free
as Brother David comes and leads us in song. And again, someone had a birthday, Sister Laurie Ballou.
The time to pray, you and I can conquer whatever comes my way. Oh, when I start my day with you, Lord, there's nothing I can't do. Although sometimes the tempter tries to bring me down, when I go to you in prayer, I know you meet me there. I can make it through the day when I take the time to pray and to start my day with you. Oh, when morning comes and burdens seem hard to bear. Oh, and I wonder, does anyone really care? And when it seems life is hopeless and everything's gone wrong, I look around and I count my blessings, and the morning doesn't seem so long. Oh, when I start my day with you, Lord, there's nothing I can't do. Although sometimes the tempter tries to bring me down. Oh, when I go to you in prayer, I know you'll be there. Oh, I can make it through the day when I take the time to pray and I start my day with you. Oh, when I start my day with you, Lord, there's nothing I can't do. Although sometimes the tempter tries to bring me down. Oh, when I go to you in prayer, I know you meet me there. I can make it through the day when I take the time to pray and to start my day with you. Well, long years ago, when out in sin, I had no hope, no peace within. Down on my knees, in agony, I prayed to Jesus and He gladly set me free. And I never shall forget the day, oh, and all the burdens of my soul were rolled away. It makes me happy, glad and free. I'll sing and shout it, for He's everything to me. Now I can feel Him at my side. My feeble steps, He comes to guide. When trials come, oh, He comforts me. Through faith in Him, over sin, I have the victory. And I never shall forget the day when all the burdens of my soul, well, they were rolled away. It makes me happy, glad, and free. I'll sing and shout, for He's everything to me. Oh, sinner, come to Jesus now. At His dear feet, just humbly bow. Confess to Him your every sin. He'll save and cleanse you, give you peace and joy within. Well, I never shall forget the day, oh, when all the burdens of my soul were rolled away. Oh, it makes me happy, glad, and free. I'll sing and shout it, for He's everything to me. Oh, and I never shall forget the day. Oh, and all the burdens of my soul, they were rolled away. It makes me happy, glad, and free. Well, I'll sing and shout it, for He's everything to me. Now I can feel Him at my side. My feeble steps, He comes to guide. Oh, when trials come, He comforts me. Through faith in Him, over sin, I have the victory. And I never shall forget the day, Well, when all the burdens of my soul are rolled away, oh, it makes me happy, glad, and free. I'll sing and shout, for He's everything. Well, oh sinner, come to Jesus now, at His dear feet, just humbly bow. Confess to Him your every sin, He'll save and cleanse you, give you peace and joy within. Oh, I never shall forget the day when all the burdens of my soul are rolled away. It makes me happy, glad and free. Oh, I'll sing and shout it, for it's everything to me. Oh, I never shall forget the day when all the burdens of my soul are rolled away. Well, it makes me happy, glad and free. Well, I'll sing and shout it, for it's everything to me. Now I can feel Him at my side. Well, my feeble steps, He comes to guide. When trials come, He comforts me. Through faith in Him over sin has the victory. And I never shall forget the day when all the burdens of my soul were rolled away. Well, it makes me happy, glad, and free. Well, I sing and shout it, for He's everything to me.
Praise the Lord. He is everything to all of His children. May the Lord bless you, and be careful going home, and remember the service Thursday night. Keep all of your brothers and sisters in the Lord in prayer throughout the week. And may the Lord bless you. Brother Adams, would you dismiss us as we leave the church?